C-3PO, of course, one of the dynamic duo who so endeared themselves to audiences in Star Wars and is now back to enthrall us in The Empire Strikes Back. That sequence you've just seen was a montage from it, and I must say, as far as I'm concerned, the picture lives up to every possible expectation. There's never a remotely dull moment in it. This C-3PO outfit is part of an exhibition that's been running at Selfridges here in London. Sadly, that's now closed. But the good news is that one of our guests this week is the man, the actor who inhabits C-3PO, Anthony Daniels. Tony, is this your actual C-3PO suit, the one you wear, or is this a replica?
It is one of your actual C-3PO suits, yes.
It looks as though it might be extremely warm to me.
Well, it's that amongst other things.
How long does it take you to insert yourself into it before shooting for the
Well, day? On the first film, it took about 2 hours because that was a different costume and was in slightly more pieces. But this one has been improved and I've improved too, so we get into it in about 20 minutes now.
And your arms are like this all day long, are they?
Yes, they can actually go down, but that bit is, as it were, there. So it's kind of hanging about. And actually, that's one of the worst bits, that arm particularly, isn't it? Yeah. He's not feeling too bright this morning.
Is he not?
No.
Well,
so he's not going to say much.
He's not the only one. But the walk looks extremely uncomfortable too. I mean, I should think.
Oh, that's faked. I mean, it's not the most comfortable way of walking around. But I decided it looked funnier if it was what I call a kind of Japanese shuffle. And it just developed, actually. And it looks, but I can walk normally in it, but it looks rather odd, actually, to see this thing walking around normally.
How does it feel inside, physically inside the helmet?
Well, it's very curious, because one of the...
Claustrophobic?
Yes, except I can cope with that. My face is about an inch behind here, and I can actually see, if I go cross-eyed, I can see the inside of it. And sometimes I do that just to avoid what's going on the outside, you see. I talk through here, and I breathe through here, in fact, so the noise comes out. And then we do it all again. We take all that down as a guide track, and then we do it again in the dubbing studio, and I watch the film on a screen and stand there mimicking his movements. It looks very funny. It looks funnier without the costume, actually. I think we might make part three without the costume. Because now I don't need it. I can
It'd be part six, in fact, wasn't it?
Because It'd that was be part six.
Five.
Oh, yeah, yes.
I've
been doing your homework.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Did you ever try to produce the voice live, as it were?
Yes, indeed. We had we tried a microphone, a tiny microphone, up there and there and there, and I end up sounding like Darth Vader. There's a lot of heavy breathing and not much else. And how I do the voice is that it's my own voice, but I speak a little higher and a little more precisely and clipped, not quite as sloppily as I do anyway.
When you're playing a human being, you can draw on observations you might have made either consciously or unconsciously. But what about him? Where does he come from?
Well, he comes from a planet called Afa. There's this strange city, Croydon, where they build robots. strange, lifeless place, devoid of any human content whatsoever. So there was no humans to draw from there. And I think he's a combination of one or two people I've met. Certainly he's not, I hope he's not like me. I mean, he's a rather irritating character. He just kind of grew as we went along, as I read the script, because he'd been very well written in the script.
Yeah. He's got a much bigger part, of course, in The Empire Strikes Back, hasn't he?
I don't know. I mean, you know, I think when you leave drama school, you stop all that thing about counting the lines.
Do you know? Come, come.
All right, you don't. But I don't know if he's got a bigger part or not. He tends to be more noticeable because he's so awful in this one. He's so irritating and keep at the moments of crisis, he keeps coming out with most stupid comments and he's terribly irritating. So I think you tend to notice him slightly more in this
How one. Much of the dialogue have you provided yourself?
Oh, it's half... It's two ways. A lot of it's from the script, but in fact, I did stop learning it in the end because we did tend to make it up as we went along. We rewrote a lot of scenes on the way, which is great. And that's one reason, after all, why you employ a human actor, to use the brain. You get the brain free, you see, with the body. So a good director, George Lucas is the same, but Irving Kirshner, we would sit down at the beginning of the scene and say, oh, you know, Tony, I think maybe say something else. Yeah, what do you say? And I used to go to dinner parties and say to people, what would you call R2-D2? And we would come up with things like verbose crustacean, which, you know, you can look that up in a dictionary. I didn't mean that. And it's quite hard to think up ridiculous insults and so on. But of course, in this film, I don't spend too much time with R2.
But do you, as an actor, get frustrated by performing within this plastic envelope?
Sometimes, yes. I think I'd be crazy not to. Fortunately, I like 3PO. I think he's quite a nice guy, but there are times that I would quite like to sort of get a sledgehammer to him and just flatten him out. Fortunately, I have another
career. I'll tell him. He's now a radio star, of course, too, isn't he?
He's going to be a radio star very soon, which will be good, because that means he doesn't have to dress up to play the part. He can actually stand in front of a microphone.
Now, which radio station is this?
This is for the BBC over here, probably, and it's for the American Broadcasting Network. And one of the ideas, you know, it's a 13 half-hour episode.
It could run for 3,000 years, I think, couldn't it?
It could. I think 3PO could last. You see, that's the thing about robots. They can last. Yeah. This fades away. Robots never die, etc. You can work the rest of that one up. The radio one should be very good, because after all, the mind will provide all that wonderful scenery, even better than in the film, actually.
Great. But are you working on the next of the Star Wars epics, which will be number six in the? There are three trilogies.
That's right.
In total,
we're in the middle of the second one.
Yeah.
And yes, there are vague plans, but nobody's got down to writing a full script or making offers or anything. But I think, you know, most of the audience has to go and see The Empire Strikes Back to work out whether 3PO is still alive at the end. I mean, you never know.
It's hard to imagine a sequel of that without you. Thank you very much indeed, Henry.
Thank you, Chris.
What's going on? Turn around! Chewbacca, I can't see! Encased him in carbonite. He should be quite well protected. If he survived the freezing process, that is.
Well, Calrissian, did he survive?
Yes, he's alive. And in perfect hibernation.
He's all yours, bounty hunter. Reset the chamber for Skywalker.
Skywalker has just landed, my lord.
Good. See to it that he finds his way in here. Calrissian, take the princess and the Wookiee to my ship.
You said they'd be left in the city under my supervision.
I am altering the deal. Pray I don't alter it any further.
Super baddie Darth Vader up to no good at all, again in The Empire Strikes Back. David Prowse, how did a West Country boy get to be one of the nastiest men in the galaxy?
It's amazing, isn't it? I was sat at home one day and I got a phone call from my agent saying, can I go and see George Lucas? And I went up to the 20th Century Fox office and George said, look, I'm making this film, which is sort of space fantasy, and I've got two parts I'd like you to consider. And I said, well, tell me what they are. And he said, well, the first part's a part of a character called Chewbacca. I said, what in the hell's Chewbacca? And he said, it was like a furry-type gorilla that goes through the film on the side of the goodies. And I thought, I turned my nose up. I thought, well, I don't fancy sort of, you know, 3 months in a gorilla skin. I said, what's the other one? And he said, well, the other one's the big villain of the film. I said, say no more, George, I'll take it. And he said, well, you would never regret this decision. And this is the result.
Was he right? Have you ever regretted it? Because Chewbacca's a very likable character.
Yeah, Chewbacca's likable, but I think Darth Vader is much more an established character in the picture. And I think he's actually become virtually the cult figure of the science fiction world.
Yes, he has indeed. Yeah. I mean, do you get adopted by science fiction societies?
Not so much adopted, but I now get requests to go and do all the science fiction conventions in America. I've got a whole tour lined up for the summer.
And what do? You just sweep on in this gear, do you?
No, I go on as myself, because you see, the big interest is to see who's behind Darth Vader. And so I go on and I really talk about my career, and I, because I've been in the business, people don't realize I've been in the business for 15 years. I've become an overnight success.
What were you doing before the phone rang?
Well, I'm in the health business as well. And up until Star Wars, I really never ever thought of myself as an actor, although, as I said, I've been in the business, you know, since 1965. I'd done a whole succession of films and television commercials and and TV series. You know, I was in all the major TV series, like The Saint and Department S and Beverly Hillbillies. And I says I'd done about 20-odd films before Star Wars came along. I did you know, things like Clockwork Orange and Up the Chastity Belt, Up Pompeii, Casino Royale.
And, of course, you're the Green Cross Man, aren't you?
And the Green Cross Man.
How tall are you? That?
Well, I'm 6'6", and I weigh about 19 stone. The Green Cross Code and Darth Vader came at the same, almost exactly the same period. In fact, the Star Wars people gave me a week off to go and film the Green Cross Code commercials, and it's marvelous because the, you know, Darth Vader has given the Green Cross Code man a lot of publicity.
Curious double casting,
yeah.
It is,
yes, because I'm the sort of the goodie on one side and the baddie on the other. And at one time, the Department of Transport nearly sacked me because they thought my image as Darth Vader would have a detrimental effect on my image as the Green Cross Code man.
It strikes me that wearing this mask, you can't see a heck of a lot, can you?
No, you have terrible vision problems. Number one, they put darkened lenses in. And of course, because of the shape of the mask, you really can't see anything further than about sort of 10 feet in front of you on the floor. So your vision really starts at about 10 feet away. So you can't see steps and things in front of you. My vision, most of my vision downwards, comes out of this breathing hole just there, which is like a Gauls affair. And then when we were doing the big fight sequence at the end, where we had to have more vision, we actually made another mask with a perspex bottom so that you could actually see better, you know, down below. But
and
we
the
only
heat
just
is fairly intense, presumably.
The heat is absolutely fantastic because not only, you see, when they made the mask, first of all, they made the mask miles too big. And then when George asked me to turn right and left, I sort of turned right and left, and the mask still stayed facing forward. So they padded the whole of the inside of the mask out with foam rubber. And of course, that made you perspire even more. And the least bit of exertion, the eyepiece is messed up, and you have to stop everything and clean out the eyepieces and see where you're going. And I said in the big fight sequence at the end, you know, you'd walk through the set and then have to be led back by three people.
The voice, of course, you don't provide. Do you find it frustrating as an actor not to be performing vocally?
Yes, terribly. I performed all the way through the picture. Because I have to learn all the dialogue, and the other actors in the film have to react to me and things like this.
But then they read dub.
But then they read dub. Yeah, I think the problem was, as you obviously realise, I have a West Country accent.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
very slight. And I don't think they could do Darth Vader with an English accent. That was the big problem. And also, you see, the character being a big black character that he is, I think George really wanted an obvious black voice, and they got James Earl Jones in to do it. And to me, that is a very obvious Negro voice. And anyway, it's a nice combination, I think. I mean, it's frustrating for me, obviously, yeah. Because, you know, I'm not
like
having
I see you're wearing your trusty, what's it called, lightsaber.
That's the lightsaber, yeah.
Is that the one you use in the movie?
That's not the one I use, but it's very, very, very similar. In the first ones that we used on the first film, they had a very fast revolving motor inside. It's almost like a double-handled torch, you know. And then they put this sort of carbon rod about 4 foot long, which was the actual lightsaber itself. And then they put reflective tape over the rod, and then as soon as you switched on, the whole thing revolved very fast and looked as though it was pulsating. On the one that we've just finished, on the original ones, they were very, very fragile. You know, Sir Alec Guinness himself were fighting merrily away, and every time they clashed, you know, you'd pick up the bits off the floor, and so you kept on having to start and stop and start.
Indeed,
and
you
stop.
Picked up the bits of Sir Alec Guinness off the floor.
I picked up Sir Alec Guinness once off the floor as well. Yeah.
David, thank you very much.
Thank you. Nice talking to you.
The Force is with you, young Skywalker.
You are not a Jedi yet.
Johnson, congratulations first of all on the Oscar for Alien and for your work on The Empire Strikes Back, which is a large part of the reason why the picture is so utterly enthralling. Now, you do design, but in this particular film, design wasn't part of your brief, was it?
No, Ralph McQuarrie, who's the conceptual artist, does most of the designs with Joe Johnston, and George Lucas has a great deal to say about what the models look like.
So once you've got the look of them, and this is incidentally what?
This is the land speeder. There are a number of these craft on the ice planet Hoth.
Yeah. Which you shot in Norway, didn't you?
Which we did in Norway, yes.
There's some of the construction crew up here, please.
Bring the gun back to us again, Alan. But Alan, if I can use the immediate thing.
Are you busy laying out the cable? Okay. Don't all stand in groups or anything. Just be busy.
From the middle of the track.
Group two now, please. Group two.
Of you, if you stand over that side, because they're shooting in that sort of.
Okay. Good lad. You are just preparing for
otherwise
a
otherwise it'd be a total joke. But go off to the left.
The war has started now.
Yeah.
The attackers are coming from over there, and you're shooting at them. There's explosions going on all around you. Okay?
Foreground
turret gun, please.
Just be ready. Be ready.
Okay, Doctor.
Take your position.
Right ground action.
Any questions? Right leader. Incoming.
What kind of problems did it give you to combine these and human beings in the same shot in Norway?
It was quite a problem. We had white snow backgrounds. The speeders were a fairly light colour. We had other objects going through as well, which were also light coloured. And making mats to fit without showing any edges is always a great difficult, you know, it's a really bad job to do. And we had to build a lot of new equipment to achieve that result.
This, for me, is one of the stars of the film. It's absolutely marvellous. They're simply called walkers, aren't they?
Yes.
Is that actual size?
That is one of the sizes, yes. We did build them in various scales.
In the picture, they look as big as camels, or no?
No, bigger, they're bigger than that. They're 50 or 60 feet.
Because one of these flies
yeah.
under the legs, isn't it?
That's correct, yeah. It actually zooms through.
How did you animate those?
Well, this is an animated model. The armatures are actually built into the whole design.
The joints
bend with constant friction, and you make one move, and then take one frame, and then make another move, and then take another frame.
And this again is a George Lucas conception.
George Lucas, Ralph McQuarrie, Joe Johnston, a number of people had a hand in the basic design.
This is the joystick that operates the camera and model functions. We've got 12 pots here,
operating 12 stepping motors, and each channel can be recorded separately and then played back through the memory system, and then we can build upon that to get our final motions. We've got camera track, model track, camera boom, model pitch, model nodal, roll, traverse, and then these are camera motions here, tilt and pan, and camera roll, and then we have two extra channels that we can record either program a focus or record motors on a model or something like that.
Okay, ready and go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, good.
Now, I think you did a lot of the movement of the land speeder here at George Lucas's private place, ILM, in the States. How did it operate?
Well, what we do is we put this model against a blue screen backing, and we have a computer-controlled camera device which tracks up and down a track and swings around on an arm and photographs this model. But we can also motorize the model to move as well.
So these flaps, for instance?
So these flaps are on little stepping motors. The heads turn on little stepping motors. So when the formation flying is going on, you see the pilot's head turn around and actually look towards the other land speeder that the camera is inside. And the flaps come up and down to operate the basic configuration of the vehicle. But computer control camera work is pretty well unique to America at the moment. And the George Lucas facility is probably the finest facility available at this time.
And in terms of time and money, then, this alone represents a tremendous investment.
Yes, it does. I mean, each model has to be manufactured so that it can do a variety of functions. And they're very expensive. And we have to build a number of different sizes of them to get all the shots in the picture, you know, because you see long shots of them and close-ups and everything else. Yeah. Each one needs a different model.
What was your biggest challenge in this film? Because you hadn't done Star Wars, had you?
No, I hadn't. I think really making sure that all the live-action stuff went together with all the model stuff, because the live-action in Norway and England was a totally separate entity from the Californian operation.
Even though you hadn't done the previous picture, you had to know the house style, as it were, of Gary Kurtz and George Lucas.
Yes.
How did you pick that up? From drawings, from seeing the film lots of times?
Looking at Ralph McQuarrie's drawings, talking to George Lucas and Gary Kurtz, and saw the movie 4 or 5 times and ran it on rock and roll so I could look at each individual shot, backwards and forwards. Yeah.
Now, you did have, of course, a couple of the mechanical stars inherited. That's R2-D2 and C-3PO. Did you make any changes to them?
C-3PO was really Tony Daniels inside the suit, so that wasn't our sort of problem. But R2-D2, we had to re-engineer all the radio control and actually redesign the shell of R2. We built it in a composite epoxy resin fiberglass molded structure rather than aluminium, and then fitted everything inside that.
Why was the change necessary?
Well, looking at the first ones, they had a few problems which slowed down shooting on the stage. So we attempted to increase the speed of shooting so we could run them for a longer period of time and not hold units up. Nevertheless, the first one also worked reasonably well. We just sort of enhanced the operation.
And it must be very flattering to you that an American production team chose English technicians such as yourself for a job like this.
Well, yes, I think partly because they have to make half the film over here. Well, that's the way they do it, so they use English technicians. And it made a lot of sense for the sort of special effects supervisor to go onto the other side as well. So there was a coordination between two units.
Brian, thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris.